Well, good morning, Lifegate. Did you recognize any of those shots in that video? That's here. That's Omaha, West Dodge. Well, if I haven't had the pleasure to meet you, my name is Brian, and I am the campus pastor here at West Dodge, and I'll have the pleasure of sharing the word with you this morning, and excited to be here. If you're a first-time guest, we think it's very cool that you're with us, and I want to welcome those watching online or listening online, but I'm not going to welcome the other campuses. The reason I'm not is that at every campus, the campus pastors are sharing. So at Midtown, Pastor Mike is preaching. At Papillion, Pastor Mike Hintz is preaching. And in Novi Sad, Serbia, Pastor Kiki is preaching. So they're just doing their own thing. And so this is a message that's custom made for West Dodge, and I'm excited to be here. You might have forgotten this, but we started a series a long, long time ago, back in June, called Think Local. And actually today we're finishing that series. And we talked about what is think local, what does that mean? We talked about who is in your locale, who the world you live in, the sphere of influence that we had, and we looked at the definition of locale as this: it's a place or locality, especially with reference to events or circumstances connected to it. And we've determined that your locale, your sphere of influence, is really determined by four factors. The first factor is geography or proximity. Where are you regularly or divinely? The second is relationships. Who am I around, by assignment or birth? I was just at a family reunion. I had no choice. I was birthed into this family, so we all have those. The third is common ground. Who do I have what do I have in common with others? And the fourth variable is passion. And this is a big one. Who am I around because of my passions and desires? So we all have a locale, we all have a sphere of influence, and many times it intersects with many, many different people. And in June, when we unpacked that series here at West Dodge, we talked about what does that look like, taking the Great Commission and taking it to my locale. And if you remember this, we talked about the Great Commission is basically preach the gospel, make disciples. But we boiled that down to who in my locale, who in my sphere needs to hear my story. And then the second week, we talked about who in my locale do I need to invest into, and who needs to invest into me. So that's what we did. Today, however, we're going to look at something. We're going to talk about the things or the tactics of the enemy that could hinder that or keep that from happening. If you brought your Bibles, if you would turn to John 10, verse 10. You know, this has been a life verse for me. It's also been a signature verse for this fellowship. As a matter of fact, we used to have it literally on the walls of this church. And here's what it says in John 10:10. It says, the thief, he comes to do three things: to kill, to steal, and destroy. Here's the good news, though. Jesus said, but I have come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. And if you look at this verse, really, these are really two job descriptions. It's Jesus' job description, and it's Satan's job description. What does Satan come to do? Satan comes to kill, physically, relationally. He comes to steal your finances, your joy, your hopes, your dreams. And he comes to destroy your life, your relationship, your future. And with that, there's a collateral damage, laundry list of guilt, shame, and lost opportunities. Now, good news is, Jesus said, but I came that you might have life and have it more abundantly. He came to bring us eternal life. We know that the shed blood of Jesus cleanses us from our sins. So not only do we get eternal life, he says, I'm going to bless you with an abundant life on your way to heaven. That's what we have in Christ. So as we think about Satan's tactics, it's very obvious. But I believe he has a couple other tactics that we're going to mention two and really talk about one that he uses to try to keep us from following Jesus. The first is distraction. Have you ever been distracted? Some of you might be distracted right now. It's easy to be distracted. I believe more so in this culture than any other time, because we're used to being stimulated. We're used to being, you know, they say the average attention span is 7.5 seconds. If you don't stimulate me in about 7 seconds, I'm going to my phone or going somewhere else. I mean, it's really bad. So I believe we live in a day where it's easy to be distracted. And I believe Satan tries to distract us, get us so busy that we lose focus on what's really, really important. And that's our relationship with God, our families, and our friends. Have you ever been busy? You meet people, you talk to them, well, how you doing? They go, well, we're busy, 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 busy. Man, we're just so busy, we're busy, we're busy, we're just busy, 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 busy. Ever, anybody ever heard that or said that? Maybe you're there right now. I don't even want to tell you what I did all this weekend. It was ridiculous. And I got to thinking, I hear that all the time, and I'm thinking, when did that become the goal? You know what would be really refreshing when you talk to somebody? Hey, Bob, how you doing? Well, you know, I've got a really good rhythm going in my life. I kind of pull back on some of the activities. We're not spending as much money, and we have peace, and we have time to do the things that are important. We don't hear that very often, do we? Andy Stanley makes a couple statements I think are profound. He says this, busyness is the enemy of intimacy. Busyness is the enemy of intimacy. He goes on to say that intimacy happens within margin. And I don't know about you, but I need more margin in my life. That's another whole story. So here's my question. What is it that distracts you from your relationship with God? It doesn't have to be anything bad. Many times it's not. But if he can't kill, steal, and destroy, he'll go on to the next thing and try to distract us. And the second one I want to talk about is this, is compromise. If Satan can't destroy you, he will attempt to defeat you by neutralizing you and the power that's within you as a follower of Jesus. And many, many times he accomplishes this through compromise. So if there was a title for this message, it would be No Compromise. You know, it's interesting, the word compromise in our current culture isn't negative because, you know, we compromise, we negotiate, we make concessions, we have settlements, we posture. But when anytime you compromise your walk with God, it's never good. It's not neutral. It's always negative. We live in a culture that is full of compromise. And it's interesting, if you take a look at our society today, we're in a mess. And here's what's happened. Anytime you remove a standard, and we're going to talk a lot about standards and non-negotiables today, but we've removed the standard of God's word and truth. And anytime you remove a standard in any culture or any setting, it's true with your kids. Chaos follows, always. See, we removed this. There's no right or wrong. It's whatever you want to do. There are no absolutes. And we know as followers of Jesus, that is absolutely not true. There is right and wrong. God's word is truth. But we've removed this. Let me ask you this. How many of you have ever been on a diet and aren't currently on it? Go ahead and raise your hand. Okay, next question. How many of you have been on a regular exercise program and not currently on it? Raise your hand. Oh my gosh, it's the same people. No, I'm just kidding. I know this from personal experience. When you're in any type of rhythm or discipline, the minute you compromise, for me anyway, it's the beginning of the end. And it's just like, well, and then just you find yourself, here's what happens. Compromise is very subtle. It's like erosion. Have you ever watched the water come on the beach? I mean, us love being on the ocean. You know, one tide doesn't take a beach away. You know what it is? It's several, little by little, and all of a sudden you find yourself somewhere you don't want to be. And that is so true in our culture. So I think we live in a world, it's absolutely imperative we have standards, that we have non-negotiables in our life. For me, and this is just me, I knew that there were certain things I had to establish in my life if I wanted to be the husband God called me to be, the dad he called me to be, the leader he called me to be, and they're what I call non-negotiables. And for me, a couple of them were, it's him time, gym time. I got those mixed up for a lot of years. It was gym time, then him time. The problem is the gym time ran into the him time, and there's no time for him. Anybody relate to that? So for me, I knew that I had to set a non-negotiable. In other words, non-negotiable means, excuse me, it's not open for discussion. With my flesh doesn't like getting up early in the morning, but we just don't have that conversation. It is a non-negotiable. It is a standard. Now, do you miss? Sure. This is not being about legalistic, but here's the deal. If you are not intentional about something, it doesn't happen. Okay, I know this has happened in this foyer because I've done this. You run into somebody. Hey, Jerry, we should go have lunch. Yeah, let's have lunch. You don't put it in the Outlook. You don't put it in the day timer. And then a year later, hey, Jerry, we should go have lunch. And 3 years later, you still haven't had lunch. So here's the deal. Anything worthwhile, you need to be intentional. John Maxwell makes a statement. Actually, Pastor Les referenced this last week. John Maxwell says, anything in life that's worthwhile is uphill. It takes effort. Relationships, marriage, a vocation, staying in shape, anything worthwhile is uphill. Problem is we have uphill dreams, but many times we have downhill habits. So compromise is right around the corner. And here's Satan uses compromise, I believe, much like temptation. Here's what it says. Once won't hurt. You ever heard that one before? How many of you know once is never once? Well, twice won't hurt. Well, 16 times won't hurt. Yeah, it will. Satan loves the subtleties. And I think we live in a culture where it's easy to become numb. You watch TV and it's porn. What was deemed pornographic even 5-10 years ago is just primetime TV. So we're inundated. You and I are tempted to compromise our values, our morals, and our walk with God on a continuing basis. A pastor friend of mine made this statement years ago. He said, if you don't stand for something, you'll fall for anything. And the spirit of this age is trying to conform you and I into his image. If you want to turn your Bibles, let's look at Romans 12, verse 2. It says this, and don't be conformed to this world. And how many of you know our culture, our society is trying to form us into what it wants us to be? It says, don't be conformed to this world. And here's how you keep from being conformed. But be transformed by the renewing of your minds so that you may prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Here's the reality. This world, this culture wants to conform you. Jesus wants to transform you and I into the image of him. So we're going to look at a story. There's a story. I have been inspired by four people in my life ever since I became a believer. This story has inspired me. Four young people. For the young people, you need to know this. Most of the characters in the Bible, they are not old. Of course, old is a relative term these days for me. They are young people. Almost throughout Scripture, they are young people that God uses. Many of the renewals and the revivals in our land have been with young people. We're going to look at the life of four young men who were ripped from their home, thrown into a very worldly pagan culture. They were immersed in a 3-year education system driven by secular and humanistic viewpoints where they had to learn new languages and new customs. Sounds like college. Had their God-given, God-honoring names changed to pagan names, living in a culture where the temptation of compromise lurked around every corner. We're going to hear about a spectacular story that's a result of a non-compromising, faith-filled lives fueled by a committed relationship. It's a story you've heard in Sunday school, but it's as relevant and it challenges us today as it did 2,600 years ago. And that's the story of Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So if you brought your Bibles, let's turn to Daniel 1. The book of Daniel is an amazing book for you Bible students. 1-6 is the life of the children of Israel, of Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Verses 7-12 is about end times. There's some amazing things in here. But here's my challenge for you all. You're all going, oh, I've heard this story. I've known this story my whole life. I believe there's some keys, some things the Lord would speak to us about the story that we can apply to our life. To set it up, Nabopolassar was the emperor of Babylon at that time. His son was Nebuchadnezzar. Ancient history was changed when they defeated the Assyrian army, and Babylon became the greatest empire in the world. It consumed most of the known world at that time. Amazing riches, wealth. Actually, Babylon is in modern-day Iraq, but it was the greatest empire in the world. Later, it was succeeded by the Medo-Persian Empire, then by the Greek Empire, and then eventually by the Roman Empire. So this is about 630 BC, 630 years approximately before Jesus was born. So they are just swallowing up lands and territories. And as was their custom, they would come into a country and everybody does this in business too. And in the church, they're looking for good leaders. Aren't we always looking for good leaders? They go, hey, let's take the best leaders out of this country and we're going to integrate them in our culture, into our government, and they're going to help us lead this vast empire. So we're going to pick this up in verse 3. Then the king instructed Aphinaz, the master of the eunuchs, to bring some of the children of Israel and some of the king's descendants and some of the nobles, young men in whom there was no blemish, but good-looking, gifted in all wisdom, possessing knowledge and quick to understand, who had ability to serve in the king's palace and whom they may teach the language and the literature of the Chaldeans. And the king appointed for them a daily provision of the king's delicacies and of the wine which he drank, and 3 years of training for them, so that at the end of that time they might serve before the king. Verse 6. Now from among those were the sons of Judah were Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. To them the chief of the eunuchs gave names. I want to stop right here. You know what the world will always try to do to you and us? Change your name. Change your identity. See, in this culture, names were very, very important. It defined who they were. It was the essence of who they were. Daniel, whose name was God is my judge, was named Belteshazzar, Lady Protect the King. Hananiah, whose God-given name was the Lord is gracious, was renamed Shadrach, I am fearful of the God. Mishael, whose name is Who is What God Is, was named Meshach, I am of little account. And Azariah, which means the Lord has helped me, he was renamed Abednego, the servant of the God Nebo. Verse 8. It's really interesting, the story of Daniel. We really focus on we're going to get to Daniel 3. That's the fiery furnace. And we talk a lot about Daniel 6. I mean, those are spectacular stories. But I believe with all my heart, those don't happen if we don't see this verse right here. Here's what it says. But Daniel purposed in his heart. He set standards. There were non-negotiables. There were certain things he was not going to do. But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with a portion of the king's delicacies, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore, he requested of the chief of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself. Now, God had brought Daniel into the favor and goodwill of the chief of the eunuchs. And the chief of the eunuchs said to Daniel, I fear my lord the king, who has appointed your food and drink. For why should he see your faces looking worse than the young men who are your age? Then you would endanger my head before the king. Now, there's a couple reasons he wouldn't eat and drink this. Number one, it was forbidden by Jewish law. Secondly, those food and drink was offered up to pagan gods. But you see, it was a standard because of their conviction. There's certain things they weren't going to do. The rest of the story goes, I'm not going to read it all, but the rest of the story goes, he said, you know, give us fruits and vegetables and let us drink water for 10 days. And if we don't look better than the rest of them, you deal with us whatever you need to do. Well, they went through that. At the end of that time period, they came back. They looked fairer and looked better. In verse 17, it says, and as for these four young men, God gave them knowledge and skill in all literature and wisdom. And Daniel had understanding in all visions and dreams. Verse 20, and in all matters of wisdom and understanding about which the king examined them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and astrologers who were in his realm. Thus, Daniel continued until the first year of King Cyrus. These were gifted people, but you know what? The thing I get out of the story, the biggest thing, God's favor was on them. Did you know God favors his kids? If you're a child of God, he favors you. I mean, we could hear story after story how situations happen and people say, I just don't know what happened. I can a lot of times tell you what happened. God favors his kids. Now, it'd be real easy to jump over to Daniel 3, which we're going to go there in just a minute. But in Daniel chapter 2, something very significant happens. And I think if you ask most people, we know about Daniel 3, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. We know about Daniel 6, which is Daniel in the lion's den. But Daniel 2, we don't a lot of times don't remember what that is. And here's a little sidebar. This is a little side note. Many, many times we look for the spectacular in God. And I love the spectacular. I love when he does his thing. But many, many times, as we look for the spectacular, we miss the everyday supernatural that he's doing in our life. The reason I say that, Daniel 2, Nebuchadnezzar has a really wild dream. It troubles him. He says, bring in the astrologers and magicians. And he goes, not only do I want you to interpret the dream, I want you to tell me what the dream was. They're going, who in the world can do that? Number one, it's hard enough to interpret. We don't know what your dream was. And so he sent a decree to execute every magician, every wise person. That was Babylonian. That was Israelite. I mean, they started executing hundreds of people. And Daniel heard about it and he goes, hey, I can help. And if you read the story, you need to read Daniel 2. And he goes and he tells him the dream. And it was very prophetic of the four kingdoms that I mentioned. It's a great story. Not only so he told him the dream, then he interpreted it. And he promoted them, and Nebuchadnezzar said, your God is God. So it's one of the less spectacular stories, but it really saved more lives than any other story in the book of Daniel. So here's my encouragement for us as we go through life. When we're looking for the spectacular, don't miss the everyday supernatural. Okay, shifting gears, Daniel 3. So things are going well. Nebuchadnezzar, verse 1, the king made an image of gold whose height was 60 cubits and its width was 6 cubits. Approximately, we're talking, it was made of solid gold, or the image of gold. We're talking 100 feet high by 10 feet wide. Talk about wealth. Talk about opulence. It was ridiculous. Talk about an ego trip. I mean, not only was Nebuchadnezzar setting himself up as the ruler of the nations, he was setting himself as the ruler of religion. I mean, he was, and we know the story, but I'm gonna skip over parts of it. And Nebuchadnezzar gathered them all together. So he gathered them all together, and the herald cried, "To you it is commanded, O people, nations, and languages," verse 4, "that at the time you hear the sound of the band in symphony with all kinds of music, you shall fall down and worship the gold image that King Nebuchadnezzar has set up, and whoever does not fall down and worship shall be cast immediately into the midst of a burning fiery furnace." Verse 7, "So at that time when all the people heard the music, all the people, nations, and languages, they fell down and worshiped the gold image which King Nebuchadnezzar had set up." This is the plain of Dura. It's 6 miles south of Babylon. It was this huge mass of people. Can you imagine a 100-foot statue? And he said, all you got to do when the music plays, you all bow down. Now, in verse 8, it's very interesting. I got a note here. It's patronization and jealousy. It's really interesting what happens here. Verse 8, "Therefore at that time certain Chaldeans," which is just another word for Babylonians, "came forward and accused the Jews. And they spoke and said to King Nebuchadnezzar," I love this, "O king, live forever." It's kind of like, oh, Nebi, you're looking good. And I really don't think they cared much about Nebuchadnezzar. I don't know that. You're looking good, buddy. Verse 10, "Then he reminds him of what he did. You, O king, have made a decree that if everyone who hears the sound of the music, they shall fall down and worship the gold image, and whoever does not fall down and worship shall be cast in the midst of a fiery furnace. Now there are certain Jews who you have appointed over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These men, O king, have not paid you due regard. They do not serve your gods or worship the gold image which you have set up." What I find very interesting, in a normal situation, he would have had them executed. But you see, there was favor on these young men. God's favor was on these young men, so Nebuchadnezzar gives them a second chance. We see this in verse 13. "The Nebuchadnezzar, in rage," he was mad, he was furious, "gave the command to bring in Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So they brought these men before the king. Nebuchadnezzar spoke, saying to them," I love this, "is it true, boys? Is it really true?" I mean, there was favor. He wouldn't have had to do this. "Is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods or worship the gold image which I have set up? Now, if you are ready, at the time you hear the sound of the horn, flute, harp, lyre, psaltery, in symphony with all kinds of music, and you fall down and worship the image which I have made, that would be good. But if you do not worship, you shall be cast immediately into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. And who is the God who will be able to deliver you from that?" Now, as I've read the story over the years, and I invite you to do this too, invite yourself into who they were. And I'm thinking, what would have I said? What would have I been thinking? Because you know what? Many of you are in fiery furnaces where you work or in relationships where there's heat, and we're tempted every day to bow our knee in situations. You know, I thought of this. They could have huddled up and said, you know what, this is bad, this is bad, this is really bad. We didn't ask to be here. Everyone else is doing it. We're going to be here for a long time. Remember Jeremiah said, this thing's going on for 70 years. We could be 90. Let's just go with the flow. No one back home will ever know. There's no sense dying over this. Or here we go. We could just do what he says. We could bow down, and then we can ask for forgiveness later. They didn't do any of that. And we're going to look at these next three verses that I believe are three of the most powerful verses in the Bible. Three young men. Verse 16. "Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter." My translation for that is, King, we don't sweat you. Remember the old Rocky movie? Polly was always saying, I don't sweat you. I don't sweat you. I mean, that's the equivalent. We have no need to even answer that. Verse 17. If that is the case, check out these words. We miss some of these words in these stories. The God whom we serve. This was not a casual relationship. This was a committed relationship to God. They served God. They were servants of God. The God whom we serve, he is well able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us from your hand, O King. You know what? When I read that verse, I see faith. I see trust. I see surrender. And here it comes. Verse 18. But even if he doesn't, Jack, let it be known unto you that we will not serve your gods and we will not worship the golden image that you have set up. Wow. I don't know that I could have done that. No compromise. No compromise. And we live in a world where we're tempted to bend our knee every day. Read the rest of the story. Nebuchadnezzar didn't like this. Nebuchadnezzar was full of fury, and the expression on his face changed toward Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego. He spoke and commanded that the heat of this furnace was turned up seven times more than it usually was heated, and he commanded certain mighty men of valor who were in the army to bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and cast them into the fiery furnace. Then these men who were bound in their coats, their trousers, their turbans, their garments, they were cast into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Therefore, because the king's command was urgent and the furnace exceedingly hot, the flame of the fire killed those men who took up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. It was so stinking hot, as they just even got close, they were incinerated. And these three men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, fell down bound into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. And to me, in that verse 24, a very peculiar verse. Then King Nebuchadnezzar, 24 and 25, was astonished, and he rose in haste and spoke to one of his counselors. Didn't we throw three guys into that furnace? They said, true, O king. And he said, look, I see four men loose walking in the midst of the fire, and they are not hurt, and the form of the fourth is like the Son of God. A pagan king prophesying. Now, historians believe it could have been an angel. It was a pre-incarnate Jesus. But he knew God was delivering them. Verse 26. Then Nebuchadnezzar went near the mouth of the burning fire furnace and spoke, saying, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, servants of the Most High God. There it is again. Come out and come here. Then they came from the midst of the fire. And the satraps, the administrators, governors, and the king's counselors gathered together, and they saw these men on whose bodies the fire had no power. The hair of their head was not singed, nor were their garments affected, and the smell of fire was not on them. I mean, you just sit around a campfire, your clothes smell like smoke. Nebuchadnezzar spoke, saying, blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who sent his angel and delivered his servants, here it is again, who trusted him. And they have frustrated the king's word and yielded their bodies that they should not serve nor worship any god except their own God. Therefore, I make a decree that any people, nation, or language which speaks anything amiss against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego shall be cut into pieces, and their houses shall be made an ash heap, because there is no other God who can deliver like this. Verse 30, and the king promoted Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the province of Babylon. You know what's amazing about the story? God not only rescued and delivered them, but he promoted and blessed them. Isn't that the way God works? Another thing in this story that really captivates me, it's interesting I use that word, is that in their captivity, God used them. In their captivity, God used them. They didn't suffer from what I call the Asuna syndrome. Have you ever heard of the Asuna syndrome? You may not have heard it because I just invented it yesterday. Here's what the Asuna syndrome is. As soon as I get a new job, I'll start walking with God. As soon as I get it together, I'll start doing the right thing. For some of us, that may never happen, okay? As soon as they change, I'll start doing the right thing. As soon as I get more money, as soon as I get out of this relation, as soon as I move to another town, as soon as, no, they said, right where we're at, this ain't good, we're in captivity, but we're gonna drive the stake in the ground. We're gonna establish standards and non-negotiables in our life. So as we look back at their resolve, here's the reality. I believe God is saying, you know what? I want you to do that as well. So here's my question. I got several questions as we close. What is it that would distract you or cause you to compromise your walk with God? Here's the deal. If Satan can distract us or neutralize us through compromise, we won't walk in victory. And victory leads to freedom. Did you know Jesus came to set the captives free? Do a quick plug for restoration. We have restoration come up in a couple weeks, September 15th and 16th. If you've not been to it, come and continue to get further healing and restoration. Does God want you and I to enjoy life? Absolutely. Does he want us to use wisdom and be smart in the process? Absolutely. So here are your action points. Action point number one, it's also our first life code. Thirst first for God. Make your relationship with God a priority. Make your devotional time a priority. Set some standards. I'm not going to tell you what those are, but the Holy Spirit can show you. Spend some time with him. Establish that relationship. Number two, identify potential vulnerable areas of your life. If you got weak spots, come alongside somebody and say, hey, I need help with this. Next one, set standards or guardrails. What are the boundaries or the non-negotiables the Lord would have you establish? I've had to do that over the years. There's certain things I just won't do, and there's certain things I just make sure I do. And God gives you grace for those. Andy Stanley has a series called Guardrails. I highly recommend it. We've actually shown it here as a fellowship several times. And it talks about putting guardrails so we don't run off the road morally, financially, relationally. Next one, be intentional. If anything is worth doing, you must be intentional. Remember, uphill dreams require uphill habits. Next one, do life with others. We can't do this by ourselves. All of our life groups are opening up. I would encourage you, if you're not in a group, our communities, our men, women, life groups, they're open now. Go to the Connect Zone. Don't do this alone. The reason I'm able to keep on the road is I got people in my life. They're checking on me, and I'm checking on them, and we're in community together. And then last, be filled with the Holy Spirit. You have a great opportunity tonight. We have encounter night. If you've never received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, I invite you to come tonight. And if you've been filled and you feel like the Holy Spirit's just leaked out of you, come and get refilled tonight. So as we close, I got a couple questions. You know, in Christ, we have victory. Did you know that? Jesus provided victory for us. 1 John 4:4 says, greater is he that is in me than he that's in the world. 1 Corinthians 15:57 says, but thanks be to God who gives us the victory. Say victory. Victory. Victory through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. But we need to walk in that victory. So as we close, three questions. What is it in your life, in your locale, that would cause you to compromise your walk with God? Is it an organization, an affiliation, an activity, a hobby, a recreation, an addiction? Who in your life or your locale would cause you to compromise your walk with God? That relationship, dating, it could be a dating relationship, business, friendship. Second question is this, what are the things that you won't do? There's certain things. There's websites I don't go to. There's movies I don't go to. There's maybe a party. I just can't afford to go there anymore. What are the boundaries? What are the things you just won't do? I remember having this conversation with my brother years ago. It really helped me. We were talking about those gray areas that you don't find right here. You know, do I go to this party? Do I go to this movie? Do I do this or do that? And he said, you know, when I'm faced with that, I always ask myself two questions. Number one, will it glorify God? And number two, will it edify me? If the answer is no to both, probably just shouldn't do it. And third, what are the things that you will do? What are the standards? What are the disciplines? What are the non-negotiables? You would say, I need this in my life, and God will give you grace to do that. So as we endeavor to live a life of no compromise, I just want to encourage us all, as followers of Jesus, let's be the standards in our locale. Let's be the light bearers. Let's be the image bearers in this world. We live in a world that is so void of morality and integrity. You know what I'm finding? A lot of people don't have integrity and character, but they want to follow someone who has some. Let's be those people. And even if you're still in captivity, let's experience the victory and freedom that comes from following Jesus and living a life of no compromise. And I believe if we do that, we'll help others walk in that victory and freedom as well. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you that your Son Jesus lived a life of no compromise. And Father God, we thank you for the examples that you give us in our word, that these individuals, they did it imperfectly, but they said, as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. That we're not going to bow our knee to the pressures of this world. So Father God, we thank you for the grace that you extend us. And Lord God, I pray for grace for each and every one of us to be intentional about the things that you would have us be intentional about. The things that are really important. And Father God, I just pray that we would recognize the distractions and the compromise that are coming against us every day, and we'll have the grace to say no. God, and give us the grace to say yes to the things we need to say yes to. Lord God, thank you so much for sending your Son Jesus. And Lord, we thank you that everything you show us in your word and you ask us to do is for our good and our blessing. Father God, we thank you. We worship you. Lord, we bow our knee to you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you so much for joining us today. We always appreciate hearing how God is moving in your life. If you've been impacted by Lifegate Church, we'd love to hear from you. Please email mystory@lifegateomaha.com. Thanks again for joining us.